pravo, da vam skrenem pažnju da je plan da će naš webinar biti sniman, tako da dobijete to kao obaveštenje i nadam se da nemate naravno problem sa tim. Također bih da vam skrenem pažnju da ukoliko želite možete da uključite i svoje kamere. Ukoliko smatrate da se osjećate konfornije, da vam kamera bude isključena, naravno ni to nije nikakav problem. S obzirom da je sada webinar počeo da se snima, ja bih da najpre poželim dobrodošlicu svima vama još jednom, također i našim panelistima, ali i da najpre poželim dobrodošlicu i izvršnoj direktorki Beogradskog centra za ljudska prava, Sonju Tošković, koja će se svima nama sada obratiti kao uvodničarka današnjeg događaja. Izvoli, Sonja.
Hvala, Vuče. Dobar dan, drage kolege i koleginice, dragi prijatelji, dragi gosti. Drago mi je da vidim da smo se okupili evo sada pred kraj godine, kada znam da je svima raspored prilično gust, tako da vam se eto u ime Beogradskog centra zahvaljujem što ste izdvojili vreme da budete danas sa nama. Verujem da mnogi od vas koji prate rad Beogradskog centra znaju da mi već godinama za redom se uvek trudimo da najmanje dva, da kažem nekada su to bila seminara, ali nažalost zbog epidemije, evo već od prošle godine, to su webinari, organizujemo na različite teme u oblasti izbjegličkog prava i uvek smo smatrali da je to korisno za sve nas, kako praktičare, tako i ljude koji se bave istraživanjem u ovoj oblasti. I jako mi je drago i stvarno sam ponosna na tim Beogradskog centra, naravno i na Vuka koji je uložio puno vremena da ovo organizuje i da ove godine razgovaramo i na jednu temu za koju smatramo da je izuzetno važna, a to je apatridija i izbjegličko pravo. Mi se u našem radu već godinama susrećemo u suštini sa ljudima koji suštinski jesu apatridi, a s druge strane jesu tražioci azila, ali ja neću ulaziti sada detaljnije u to, s obzirom da je ceo webinar posvećen ovoj temi i verujem da će biti vrlo korisna i zanimljiva i diskusija i rasprava, ako je uopšte dozvoljeno, Vuče, izvini sada, pošto je webinar. Ne znam da li će postojati mogućnost, ali mislim da je vrlo korisno, s obzirom da se svi negde na terenu i u praksi susrećemo sa ovim pitanjem, tako da stvarno sam srećena što su i kolege iz Evropske mreže za apatridiju danas tu sa nama, što će podeliti neka uporedno pravna iskustva iz kojih verujem da možemo i mi dodatno da naučimo, tako da ja ne bih ništa više zadržavala, osim da vam stvarno poželim uspešan webinar i da budete sa nama i da izdržite ovo vreme koje je određeno za webinar. Eto, toliko od mene i ja ću se sad isključiti.
Hvala najlepše, Sonja. Još samo par tehničkih napomena. Dakle, ukoliko ste se naknadno pridružili našem webinaru, potrebno je dakle samo da isključite svoj zvuk, dakle mikrofon na kod vas. Webinar će trajati, plan je da traje dakle dva časa. Prvi deo webinara bit će na srpskom jeziku, a drugi deo webinara koleginice iz Evropske mreže za apatridiju će govoriti na engleskom jeziku. Ukoliko imate nekih tehničkih problema ili ukoliko se ne čujemo kako treba, možete da pišete u chat box, koji se nalazi također dakle, u donjem tabu, označen sa, na engleskom piše chat, možete tu da kliknete i da nam se obratite tokom trajanja webinara. Također, ukoliko imate pitanja za paneliste koje ne želite da zaboravite i hoćete da ih postavite odmah, također možete da učinite to tako što ćete pisati u chat box. Tako da svakako na kraju webinara imat ćemo mogućnosti za pitanja i odgovore na panel diskusiji, ali naravno ovo ostaje kao opcija da možete postaviti pitanje i odmah. Ja bih dakle, još jednom predstavio naše današnje paneliste, to su Milan Radojev, pravni koordinator iz naše organizacije NGO Praxis Serbia, dakle iz Srbije, i naše koleginice iz Evropske mreže za apatridiju, koleginica Nina Murray i Patricija Cabral, koja će nam se obraćati u drugom delu webinara. Tako da, ukoliko se slažete, možemo da počnemo sa našim prvim panelom koji se tiče apatridije, definicije, uzroka, zaštite i prevencije. I ja sada dajem reč sa velikim zadovoljstvom našem kolegi Milanu Radojevu iz organizacije Praxis. Izvolim, Milane, i hvala što ti danas tu sa nama.
Hvala puno tebi, Vuče, i hvala vam što ste mi pružili priliku da evo ponešto kažemo o ovim pitanjima. Državljanstvo se najčešće definiše kao pravom uređen odnos između pojedinca i države koji rađa uzajamna prava i obaveze na obe strane, dakle i za pojedinca i za državu. Svako ima pravo na državljanstvo, tako je rečeno još davno u Univerzalnoj deklaraciji o ljudskim pravima. Međutim, i danas, mnogo godina kasnije, i dalje veliki broj ljudi u svetu se suočava sa problemom da nema državljanstvo ni jedne države, to jest da su apatridi. Prema procenama UNHCR-a, trenutno u svetu živi više od 12 miliona ljudi koji nemaju državljanstvo ni jedne zemlje. Neke procene govore čak i o tome da ih ima više od 15 miliona. A takođe se procenjuje da se na svakih 10 minuta negde u svetu rodi dete koje nema ničije državljanstvo. Izraz apatrid ili lice bez državljanstva označava osobu koju ni jedna država prema svom pravu ne smatra svojim državljaninom. To je definicija koju sadrži Konvencija o pravnom položaju lica bez državljanstva iz 1954. godine. Važno je naglasiti da ova sintagma prema svom pravu ima dva svoja aspekta, ili prema svom pravu, ili kako se to u zvaničnom prevodu konvencije, definicije iz konvencije kaže kod nas, prema svom zakonodavstvu. Dakle, ima dva aspekta. Jedno se odnosi na same propise i na ono što piše u njima, a drugo se odnosi na primjenu tih propisa u praksi. Drugim rečima, bez obzira što bi pravo određene zemlje, odnosno zakoni te zemlje, garantovali određenom pojedincu pravo na državljanstvo, ukoliko se odredbe tog zakona ne sprovode i ne primenjuju u praksi, ta osoba biće svejedno apatrid. Čini se zapravo da definicija na engleskom jeziku, koji se kaže under the operation of its law, na mnogo bolji način ukazuje na ta dva značajna aspekta ove definicije, nego što je to reč sa našim prevodom koji kaže prema svom zakonodavstvu. Inače, državljanstvo je preduslov za pristup velikom broju prava. Zbog toga što nemaju državljanstva, apatridi najčešće ne mogu da dobiju ni lične dokumente, ne mogu da se zaposle, ne mogu da ostvare pravo na zdravstvenu ili socijalnu zaštitu, ne mogu da se venčaju, ne mogu svoju decu da upišu u matične knjige, niti da budu priznati kao njihovi roditelji. Ne mogu slobodno da se kreću, ne mogu da stiču imovinu na svoje ime, ne mogu da se školuju uglavnom. Takođe može da se desi da budu izloženi riziku od produženog boravka u pritvoru ili u prihvatilištima za strance. Kada je reč o uzrocima nastanka apatridije, postoje brojne okolnosti koje mogu da dovedu do te pojave, i među njima su, na primjer, diskriminatorni zakoni politike i prakse. Tako u mnogim zemljama se postavljaju veoma teški uslovi za prijem u državljanstvo koje mnogi pripadnici manjina ne mogu da ispune. To bi bili, na primjer, da se traži poznavanje jezika ili da se zahteva dugogodišnja prijava boravka u određenoj zemlji, iako bez ličnih dokumenata to nije moguće ostvariti, ili se kao uslov za prijem u državljanstvo postavlja materijalno obezbeđenje, to jest da se poseduju sredstva za izdržavanje, a pripadnici manjina su veoma često pogođeni siromaštvom i uglavnom nemaju pristup tržištu rada ili im je taj pristup veoma ograničen. Takođe, postoje prakse loše nekih država da se verskim zajednicama, na primjer, uskraćuje ili otežava pristup državljanstvu. Inače, se procenjuje da negde više od 3/4 od ukupnog broja apatrida u svetu pripada nekim manjinskim grupama. Dodao bih još jedan ovde diskriminatornu praksu, to je da, odnosno, diskriminatorne zakone, da da i dalje u prilično velikom broju zemalja dete ne može da stekne državljanstvo po osnovu državljanstva majke, nego samo po osnovu državljanstva oca, tako da u slučaju ako je otac nepoznat ili je i sama patrid dete, ne može da dobije državljanstvo uprkos tome što majka njegova ima državljanstvo. Dalje, sukobi zakona o državljanstvu takođe predstavljaju moguć uzrok nastanka apatridije. Tu je najčešće reč o tome da države čije sticanje državljanstva u konkretnom slučaju bi došlo u obzir imaju različite osnove za sticanje državljanstva. To bi, na primjer, bio slučaj da se dete rodi u određenoj zemlji, a ta zemlja propisuje da državljanstvo te zemlje se stiče ne po osnovu rođenja, nego po osnovu porekla. Dakle, da bi trebalo da se dobije državljanstvo one zemlje čije državljanstvo imaju roditelji. E sad, ako državljanstvo te zemlje roditelja propisuje drugačiji osnov za sticanje državljanstva, to je da ta zemlja prihvata kao osnov državljanstva rođenju u toj zemlji, došlo bi se u situaciji da kada ovo dete ne ispunjava uslove za sticanje državljanstva ni po zakonu države u kojoj je rođenju, ni po zakonu države čiji su državljani njegovi roditelji i na taj način zapravo ostaje bez državljanstva. Dalje, čest uzrok pojave apatridije jeste i sukcesija država. Tako veće grupe ljudi ili pojedinci mogu ostati bez državljanstva u slučaju kada prestane da postoji, na primjer, raspadne se zemlja u čiji su oni državljani ili kada delovi te zemlje padnu pod kontrolu ili vlast neke druge države, a ti građani ne ispune uslove koje postavlja država sukcesor, dakle ne ispune uslove za državljanstvo te zemlje. Kada su ove, dakle, ovakve teritorijalne promene u pitanju, dakle, može da dođe do pojave apatridije s jedne strane, ali takođe može da dođe do drugih negativnih posledica, da državljani steknu državljanstvo neke zemlje sa kojom zapravo nemaju nikakvu efektivnu vezu. Dalje, što se tiče uzroka koji mogu dovesti do pojave apatridije, tu su i promene, odnosno odricanje od državljanstva. Naime, u pojedinim slučajevima dešava se da se neko odrekne državljanstva jedne države, očekujući da će dobiti državljanstvo neke druge zemlje. Međutim, to se iz nekog razloga ne dogodi i u slučajevima ako ne postoje zaštitne mere koje će obezbediti, dakle, da se ponovo vrati državljanstvo staro toj osobi ili da na neki način zadrži, ti ljudi takođe mogu postati apatridi. S druge strane, lišenje državljanstva je takođe jedan od češćih uzroka, moglo bi se reći, nastanka apatridije. Dakle, tu se radi o oduzimanju ili o prestanku državljanstva nekom pojedincu ili skupinama ljudi protivno njihovoj volji. Razlozi mogu biti, na primjer, to što je neko stekao državljanstvo na osnovu prevare ili zbog nekih mera bezbednosti koje preduzima država, a zbog, na primjer, učešća u oružanim snagama neke druge zemlje ili povezanosti, da li stvarne, da li pretpostavljenosti sa terorizmom i slično. Takođe, nedostatak upisa u matične knjige rođenih je još jedan od uzroka pojave apatridije, jer bez upisa u matičnu knjigu rođenih može biti znatno otežano sticanje ili dokazivanje državljanstva. U nekim zemljama zakoni ili prakse su takvi da određenim licima uskraćuju mogućnost upisa u matičnu knjigu rođenih. To bi, recimo, bilo da se uskraćuje mogućnost da se upišu deca čiji roditelji ne posjeduju lične dokumente. Takođe, razlog na upisivanje može biti u nekim slučajevima i strah roditelja koji nemaju regulisan svoj status, pre svega imigracioni, pa se onda plaše da odu u neku instituciju ili neki organ da prijave rođenje deteta. A upis u matičnu knjigu rođenih može biti otežan zbog, na primjer, previsokih taksi ili nekih drugih administrativnih prepreka. Upravo administrativne prepreke mogu biti i zapravo prepreka i uzročnik ili bar da predstavlja opasnost za od pojave apatridije i zbog toga što se, na primjer, za sticanje državljanstva često traži da se pribavi veliki broj dokaza koje je jako teško pribaviti. Dalje, moguće prepreka da bude to što su organi gde treba pokrenuti postupak, odnosno podneti zahtjev za državljanstvo veoma udaljeni od mesta boravka. Takođe, visoke takse za prijem u državljanstvo su veoma česta pojava. Dalje, ljudi koji apliciraju za državljanstvo su po pravilu veoma, zapravo neuki su, nemaju ni pravna znanja, često su, mogu biti i nepismeni, a dakle njima je skoro uvek potrebna besplatna pravna pomoć, a i to je dakle veoma čest problem, odnosno ne postoji pristup besplatnoj pravnoj pomoći. Dalje, takođe, tu je, možemo uvrstiti diskriminatorni odnos službenika i tako dalje. Lista, dakle, ovde sam naveo priličan broj nekih uzroka, ali lista se tu tih potencijalnih uzroka ni u kom slučaju ne završava. Dakle, postoji drugi uzroci poput migracije, o tome će nešto više reći koleginice iz Evropske mreže za pitanja apatridije. Dakle, dalje tu mogu biti uzrok, može biti usvojenje, zatim surogat materinstvo. To sadašnje iskustvo je pokazalo da se s vremena na vreme lako mogu pojaviti neki novi, dotad nepoznati uzroci apatridije. Nije loše napomenuti da svi ovi uzroci se neretko prožimaju, dakle da na delu imamo dejstvo nekoliko uzroka istovremeno. Što se tiče međunarodnih ugovora koje se odnose na apatridiju, pravo na državljanstvo kao međunarodno priznato ljudsko pravo proklamovano je Univerzalnom deklaracijom o ljudskim pravima 1948. godine. Univerzalnom deklaracijom propisano je da svako ima pravo na državljanstvo, kao i da niko ne sme samovoljno biti lišen državljanstva, niti prava da promeni državljanstvo. Pravo na državljanstvo kasnije je garantovano i Međunarodnim paktom o građanskim i političkim pravima i konvencijom o pravima deteta. Tako, konvencija o pravima deteta propisuje da dete mora biti registrovano odmah nakon rođenja i da od rođenja ima pravo na državljanstvo, a u konvenciji se posebno naglašava da države moraju da obezbede ova prava u slučajevima ako bi dete inače ostalo apatrid. Međunarodni pakt o građanskim i političkim pravima takođe propisuje da svako dete odmah nakon rođenja mora da upisano u matičnu knjigu rođenih i da dobije lično ime, kao i da svako dete ima pravo na državljanstvo. Dalje, 1954. i 1961. godine donete su dve konvencije koje su predstavljale i predstavljaju ključne instrumente u nastojanjima međunarodne zajednice da odgovori na problem apatridije. To su Konvencija o pravnom položaju lica bez državljanstva iz 1954. godine, koja obezbeđuje osnovna prava licima bez državljanstva i njen prevashodni cilj je zaštita apatrida. S druge strane, Konvencija o smanjenju broja lica bez državljanstva iz 1961. godine usmerena je na sprečavanje apatridije i na smanjenje broja lica bez državljanstva, i propisuje brojne zaštitne mere koje bi države potpisnice koje treba da unesu u svoje zakone. Dalje od instrumenata koji se bave pitanjama apatridije, svakako se može svrstati i konvencija o otklanjanju svih oblika rasne diskriminacije. Ona naime obavezuje države da svakom licu obezbede jednakost pred zakonom u pogledu određenih prava, uključujući i pravo na državljanstvo. Dalje imamo konvenciju o eliminisanju svih oblika diskriminacije žena, koja proglašava jednakost muškaraca i žena u vezi sa pitanjem državljanstva i takođe nalaže državama da obezbede to da sklapanje braka sa stranim državljaninom ili promena državljanstva muža nemaju automatski za posledicu promenu državljanstva žene, niti posledica sme da bude to da ona ostane bez državljanstva ili da bude prisiljena da uzme državljanstvo muža. Za sprečavanje apatridije među decom posebno je važna odredba ove konvencije koja nalaže državama da obezbede da deca mogu da steknu državljanstvo na osnovu državljanstva majke jednako kao što to mogu i na osnovu državljanstva oca. Konvencija o državljanstvu udate žene iz 1957. takođe ima nekoliko odredaba koje treba da obezbede da na državljanstvo žene neće automatski da utiče sklapanje braka sa strancem, te da sticanje ili odricanje državljanstva od strane muža neće sprečiti ženu, to je suprugu, da zadrži svoje državljanstvo, kao i to, s druge strane, se garantuje udatim ženama, odnosno predviđa se da im se mora omogućiti da pod povlašćenim uslovima steknu državljanstvo supruga. Kada je reč o regionalnim konvencijama za evropske države, značajna je Evropska konvencija o državljanstvu iz 1997. Ova konvencija obuhvata pitanja sticanja, zadržavanja, gubitka i ponovnog sticanja državljanstva, zatim procesna prava u postupcima koje se odnose na državljanstvo. Dalje, pitanje dakle, državljanstva u okolnostima sukcesije država, a takođe sadrži i brojne odredbe koje imaju za cilj sprečavanje nastanka apatridije. Osim nje, na evropskom tlu je na snazi i konvencija Saveta Evrope o sprečavanju apatridije u vezi sa sukcesijom država iz 2006. godine, mada ovu konvenciju za sada nije ratifikovao veliki broj država, tek njih 7. Što se tiče položaja lica bez državljanstva i njihovim pravima i zaštitom tih prava, potrebno je napomenuti da neka osnovna ljudska prava važe za sva ljudska bića, bez obzira na to da li su apatridi i da li imaju utvrđen status, odnosno da li su državljani i da li imaju utvrđen status apatrida. To bi bili, na primjer, pravo na život, zabrana diskriminacije ili zabrana mučenja. S druge strane, prilično davno je se uvidjelo da je potrebno da se apatridima pruže zaštita, posebna zaštita, zapravo da se donesu neki posebni instrumenti koji će biti namenjeni isključivo njihovoj zaštiti. Najvažniji takav instrument, nema sumnje, je Konvencija o pravnom položaju lica bez državljanstva iz 1954. I u pogledu većine prava koja garantuje ove konvencije, propisano je da države treba da tretiraju apatride na što je moguće povoljniji način, a u najmanju ruku na način koji je predviđen za strance u toj zemlji. Tako su, to se odnosi pre sve, između ostalog na prava na imovinu, na lukrativno zaposlenje, na obrazovanje, na stanovanje, na slobodu kretanja. Što se tiče ostalih prava, države potpisnice bi trebalo da licima bez državljanstva koji zakonito borave na njihovoj teritoriji pruže isti nivo zaštite kao što se pruža domaćim državljanima. I to su, na primjer, prava na slobodno ispovedanje vere, pravo intelektualne svojine, pravo pristupa sudovima, socijalnoj pomoći, radnim pravima i socijalnoj sigurnosti. Osim toga, konvencija propisuje da će države ugovornice izdati lične isprave svakom licu bez državljanstva koje se nalazi na njenoj teritoriji, a nema važeću putnu ispravu. Dok je propisano da putne isprave treba da izda osobama koje zakonito borave na toj teritoriji, osim ukoliko razlozi nacionalne bezbednosti ili javnog reda ne zahtevaju drugačije. Međutim, države se takođe podstiču da i licima koji nezakonito, odnosno apatridima koji nezakonito borave na njenoj teritoriji, dakle da i njima izdaju putne isprave i pritom treba da naročito obrate pažnju na to da li ove osobe nisu u stanju da dobiju putne isprave zemlje njihovog redovnog boravišta. Dalje, prema odredbama konvencije, lica bez državljanstva koja zakonito borave u određenoj državi, potpisnici ne smeju biti proterana, osim opet ako to ne zahtevaju razlozi bezbednosti ili javnog reda, a takođe konvencija nalaže državama potpisnicima da olakšaju naturalizaciju, odnosno prijem u državljanstvo licima bez državljanstva. Dakle, moglo bi se reći da konvencija apatridima garantuje značajan broj prava. Međutim, za realizaciju, naravno, tih prava nije dovoljno samo da one budu proklamovane, nego je potrebno da mogu da se ostvare i u praksi. E sad, jedan od preduslova da bi se to dogodilo svakako je i to da neko može da dokaže da je baš on apatrid, to jest potrebno je da ima na neki način utvrđen status apatrida, odnosno lice bez državljanstva. Konvencija iz 1954. ne propisuje mehanizme koji bi se bavili tim pitanjem, ali iz njenih odredaba implicitno proizlazi obaveza država i dužnost njihova da identifikuju lica bez državljanstva koja se nalaze na njenoj teritoriji, jer samo na taj način bi mogla da im pruži odgovarajuću zaštitu i tretman i zapravo samo na taj način može da im da ispuni svoje obaveze koje je preuzela potpisivanjem konvencije. Dakle, drugim rečima, svaka država trebalo bi da utvrdi, odnosno ustanovi proceduru za utvrđivanje statusa lica bez državljanstva. Ipak za sada tek nekolicina država je to uradila, nekih 20 država u celom svetu za sada samo ima postupak za utvrđivanje statusa apatrida. Međutim, važno je u vezi sa tim naglasiti da utvrđivanje statusa apatrida, premda licima bez državljanstva omogućava pristup, trebalo bi da omogući pristup i olakša pristup pravima. Dakle, utvrđivanje takvog statusa ni u kom slučaju ne sme da bude konačno rešenje, već samo privremeno. A krajnji cilj mora da bude to da svaka osoba stekne nečije državljanstvo. Takođe, utvrđivanje statusa apatrida ne bi bilo primereno za takozvane in situ apatride, to jest za ljude koji žive u zemlji u kojoj su rođeni i s kojom su uspostavili snažne veze. Dakle, to bi svakako pre u obzir dolazilo prijem u državljanstvo te zemlje nego utvrđivanje statusa apatrida, dok bi utvrđivanje statusa apatrida bilo primerenije za migrantsku populaciju pre svega. Što se tiče prevencije, odnosno sprečavanja apatridije i pitanje koje bi to bile mere koje bi mogle da spreče pojavu apatridije, moglo bi se ukratko reći da su to zapravo one mere koje otklanjaju uzroke nastanka apatridije. Tako u slučajevima diskriminatornih zakona, politika i praksi, bilo bi potrebno izmeniti takve odredbe i prakse i uskladiti ih pre svega sa konvencijom o smanjenju broja lica bez državljanstva, ali i sa drugim međunarodnim instrumentima koji su usmereni na koji imaju odredbe koje su usmerene na izbjegavanje apatridije ili koje garantuju pravo na državljanstvo. Dalje, potrebno je osigurati da načelo zabrane diskriminacije bude ugrađeno u ustave i zakone države, ali takođe i da se primenjuje u praksi. Kada je reč o sukobu zakona kao uzroku državljanstva, tu su dolaze u obzir mnogobrojni mehanizmi koji bi mogli da spreče taj razlog, ali čini se da bi verovatno i najdelotvorniji to da bi države trebalo da svakoj osobi koja se rodi na njenoj teritoriji daju državljanstvo ako bi ta osoba inače ostala bez ičeg državljanstva. Što se tiče sukcesije država, nastanak apatridije trebalo bi sprečavati međudržavnim sporazumima, ali ako takvi sporazumi ne postoje ili ih nije moguće postići, države bi trebalo da daju svoje državljanstvo onim osobama koje bi inače ostale bez državljanstva, a takođe države sukcesori morale bi da ublaže uobičajene zahteve koji se zahtevaju za prijem u državljanstvo osobama koje se nalaze u riziku od apatridije, dakle koje mogu da u suprotnom ostanu bez državljanstva. Nastanak apatridije u slučaju odricanja od državljanstva moguće je preduprediti odredbama u zakonima koje bi sprečili to da se neko odrekne svog državljanstva sve dok ne pruži pouzdan dokaz da će steći državljanstvo neke druge zemlje. A kada je reč o lišavanju državljanstva, neophodno je da se države prilikom eventualnog lišavanja državljanstva da se rukovode principima kao što su to izbjegavanje apatridije, zabrana diskriminacije, zabrana proizvoljnog lišavanja državljanstva i da se garantuje pravo na pravično suđenje. Država ne bi ni u kom slučaju smela da liši bilo pojedinca, bilo grupe svojih državljana, svog državljanstva iz rasnih, etničkih, verskih ili političkih razloga. Važna mera za sprečavanje apatridije među decom jeste obezbeđenje da svako dete bude upisano u matičnu knjigu rođenih, i to odmah nakon rođenja, a takođe i da se omogući detetu koje bi inače ostalo bez državljanstva da stekne državljanstvo te države. Takođe je potrebno otkloniti razne loše administrativne prakse i prepreke. Dakle, takse ne smeju da budu nerazumno visoke, ne sme se od stranaka tražiti da pribavljaju bezbroj dokaza koje uzgledi jako teško pribaviti. Mora se siromašnim građanima omogućiti pristup besplatnoj pravnoj pomoći. Važno je eliminisati diskriminatorno ponašanje službenika i tako dalje. I to su uglavnom, ovako bio neki uvid na međunarodne, instrumente i položaj apatrida u međunarodnom pravu. A kada je reč o našem pravnom sistemu, Srbija je ratifikovala konvencije iz 1954. i 1961. kao i većinu drugih međunarodnih instrumenata koje sam pominjao, osim Evropske konvencije o državljanstvu i konvencije Saveta Evrope o sprečavanju apatridije u vezi sa sukcesijom država. Kada je reč o domaćim propisima, Zakon o strancima iz 2018. godine doneo je prvi put definiciju lica bez državljanstva, a pored toga ovaj zakon je propisao da se licima bez državljanstva izdaje putna isprava, a pruža im se i mogućnost prijave privremenog boravka, s tim što zakon propisuje veoma teške uslove za prijavu boravka koje je potrebno ispuniti. Zakon je takođe propisao i to da će se na lica bez državljanstva primenjivati odredbe konvencije iz 1954. ako su odredbe konvencije povoljnije za tu osobu. Osim zakona o strancima, još nekoliko zakona garantuje određena prava licima bez državljanstva. Tako im je zakonom o radu garantovano pravo da zasnuju radni odnos, zakonom o socijalnoj zaštiti priznaje im se pravo da budu korisnici prava i usluga socijalne zaštite, zakon o zdravstvenoj zaštiti, licima bez državljanstva koja su stalno nastanjena ili privremeno boravi u Srbiji daje se pravo na zdravstvenu zaštitu, dalje zakon o osobama sistema obrazovanja i vaspitanja propisuje da lica bez državljanstva imaju pravo na obrazovanje pod istim uslovima i na način kao što to imaju i domaći državljani. Zakon o zabrani diskriminacije pruža zaštitu svima, uključujući i lica bez državljanstva, a zakon o besplatnoj pravnoj pomoći propisuje da i lica bez državljanstva mogu biti korisnici besplatne pravne pomoći. Dakle, to su prava koja garantuju, proklamuju zakoni, ali mogućnost ostvarivanja ovih prava u praksi je pod velikim znakom pitanja. I to upravo zbog onog što sam pominjao. Dakle, u Srbiji ne postoji procedura za utvrđivanje statusa apatrida, tako da građani koji nemaju državljanstvo ne mogu da dokažu da su apatridi, a samim tim ne mogu ni da pristupe ovim pravima. Praksis je evo, već 15-ak i više godina pruža besplatnu pravnu pomoć licima u riziku apatridije i dakle možemo iz prve ruke da posvedočimo da lica koji nemaju lične dokumente, a to će svakako slučaj biti sa apatridima i licima u riziku od apatridije, dakle da ne mogu da pristupe skoro ni jednom od ovih prava. Takođe u našem pravnom sistemu otežavajuće okolnosti to što Zakon o državljanstvu ne poznaje pojednostavljenu proceduru za prijem u državljanstvo apatrida. A važno je istaći i to da postoje nekoliko nedostataka u zakonima, našim zakonima i u praksi organa koji predstavljaju potencijalne uzročnike za nastanak apatridije. To bi bili pre svega, to je da zapravo to što ne mogu sva deca da se upišu odmah nakon rođenja u matičnu knjigu rođenih, dakle, deca čiji roditelji nemaju lične dokumente, ne mogu odmah nakon rođenja da budu upisane u matične knjige, iako je to nešto što garantuju međunarodne konvencije. Dalje, postupci naknadnog upisa u matičnu knjigu rođenih su često opterećeni brojnim nepravilnostima. Dalje, deca koja se rode u Srbiji, koja bi inače ostala bez državljanstva, neće automatski steći državljanstvo Srbije, iako je tako predviđeno u zakonu, već je praksa takva da moraju da pokreću dugotrajne, možda i skupe postupke za sticanje državljanstva. I takođe je problem što se ovaj odnos, dakle, osnov, to jest sticanje državljanstva na osnovu rođenja u Srbiji odnosi samo na decu do 18 godina, a to je u suprotnosti sa konvencijom iz 1954. 61. godine. To je dakle bio neki onako kratak pregled nekih važnijih pitanja koje se odnose na apatridiju. Evo, ja bih sa ovim za sada završio. Ako bude potrebe posle, rado ću se uključiti.
Hvala najlepše, Milane. Ja se nadam da se mi čujemo, da me svi dobro čujete. Zaista, ovo bih, ja bih rekao, jedan veoma temeljan prikaz kakva je situacija trenutno sa apatridijom, od pojma preko uzroka, zaštite, prevencije. Mislim da smo danas stekli jedan dosta jasniji uvid u to kako uopšte taj fenomen apatridije funkcioniše i kako utiče na svakodnevni život. Pa bi ja sada s tim u vezi i definitivno prešao na dakle, našu drugi deo današnjeg webinara, gde ćemo apatridiju povezati sa izbjegličkim pravom. Najpre bih da napomenem još jednom svima da ukoliko imate neka pitanja, možete da ih postavite u chat boxu tako što ćete kliknuti dakle, na tab koji se nalazi u vašem donjem delu ekrana ili sa strane, u zavisnosti koji uređaj koristite, i tu možete da postavite pitanje i da naglasite samo da li je pitanje za Milana ili za naše koleginice koje će govoriti uskoro. Danas ćemo završiti deo webinara čiji radni jezik je srpski, pa ćemo preći sada na drugi deo webinara gde će radni jezik biti engleski. I s tim u vezi skrećem pažnju samo da takođe možete da koristite opciju prevođenja, tako što ćete na ovom tabu gde su vam ponuđene opcije izabrati opciju interpretation i onda ćete klikom na dugme, dakle interpretation, language interpretation, da izaberete srpski ili engleski kako biste mogli da nastavite da pratite drugi deo webinara. S tim u vezi, ja ću takođe sada nastaviti da pričam na engleskom, pa ćemo se onda u panel diskusiji vratiti na komunikaciju i na srpskom i na engleskom. So it is my great pleasure to now give floor to our colleagues from the European Network on Statelessness, to Nina Murray, who is Head of Policy and Research, and Patricia Cabral, Legal Policy Officer. Thank you very much for being here with us today, and we are very much looking forward to hear from your expertise on the topic of statelessness and the refugee law.
Thank you, Vuk, and good morning, everyone. Thank you for having us here today. As Vuk said, I'm Nina Murray. I'm Head of Policy and Research at the European Network on Statelessness. And I'll let my colleague Patricia introduce herself too before we start.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Patricia, and I'm the Legal Policy Officer, as Vuk has already said, at the European Network on Statelessness. It's really a pleasure to be here today, and we hope this can be a really interesting discussion as well.
Thanks. And thank you also to Milan from our colleagues at Praxis for that really comprehensive introduction to statelessness. That was really useful. And also to the interpreters for doing a great job enabling us to understand the technical legal presentation. So thank you for that. So just briefly to introduce you maybe to ENS, for those of you who are not familiar with ENS. And Patricia, I think you're going to share your screen. We have a presentation for you as well. Great. So ENS is a civil society alliance of about 170 organizations in 41 countries around Europe. Our members range from stateless activists and community organizations to NGOs, law centers, like Belgrade Center for Human Rights and Praxis in Serbia, as well as individual academics and legal experts. Our work broadly covers three main pillars or areas of activity. So we do information and awareness raising, law and policy development, and training and capacity building. And we work across four broad thematic areas, including forced migration, refugees, which is one of what we're going to focus on today, but we also work on access to justice, detention, child rights, and anti-discrimination, with a particular focus on Roma statelessness. One of the issues that Milan mentioned is quite relevant in the Serbian context as well. But today we're going to focus on the refugee context, of course. Our colleague Alison, our policy and advocacy officer, is also with us today in the webinar, and she's sharing some links with you in the chat as we go along where you can find more information. So today, this is what we're going to cover today between myself and Patricia. So there'll be about probably about 30 to 45 minutes of presentation from us, and then we'll have some time for discussion and questions, and we'd be happy to answer your questions afterwards. And we can share the presentation with you afterwards as well, if that's useful. So firstly, let's quickly just remind ourselves of the definitions, the international legal definitions of a stateless person and a refugee. Milan already mentioned the international legal definition of a stateless person, but just to note that here, Article 1 of the 1954 Convention relating to the status of stateless persons contains that definition. And you will all, I'm sure, be familiar with the definition of a refugee from the 1951 Convention. So this is also just to highlight that they're different. So the two definitions are different, of course, in international law, but a refugee can be stateless and a stateless person can also be a refugee. And that's what we're going to focus on today. And Patricia will explore this relationship between statelessness and refugee law in more detail a bit later. But firstly, I want to focus a bit on broadly why statelessness is relevant in the refugee context, why it's relevant to you as actors working with refugees in the refugee context. So at its most basic level, it's relevant because statelessness can be both a cause and a consequence of displacement. And we know, for example, from the European Economic Area, where we have data relating to asylum applicants and nationality, we know that around 3% of asylum applicants to the European Economic Area are recorded as stateless or having unknown nationality. As I understand it from colleagues in Serbia, the Serbian government doesn't publish disaggregated data on the nationality or statelessness of asylum applicants, just country of origin data, which is obviously slightly different. But this means that stateless refugees and asylum seekers are quite likely to be hidden in the official statistics in Serbia. So this is just this on this slide, you can just see some data from Eurostat, which you probably know is the EU's database on asylum applicant or the EU's database, but you can find in there data on first-time asylum applicants. And there is a category for stateless and a category for unknown nationality. But as we'll hear in a moment, we think this is an under-reporting of the real issue of statelessness within the context of asylum. So even in countries where we do have figures for the nationality of asylum applicants and the statelessness of asylum applicants, we think it is very likely to be an underestimate because there aren't really any mechanisms to accurately identify and record statelessness in the context of asylum procedures. And official figures for the number of people recorded as stateless don't fully capture the wider affected population. So what do I mean by this? So when we look more closely at the countries of origin of people, for example, in Serbia, and we've picked up some data from your most recent report on the rights to asylum in the Republic of Serbia. So if we look more closely at these countries of origin, we can see already some potential risks of statelessness or hidden stateless populations. So for example, Afghanistan, we know that many Afghans have been displaced for years and face major hurdles to acquiring identity documents and proof of citizenship, which can lead to a risk of statelessness. So for example, we know that Afghans in Iran, for example, who've been displaced for generations often face significant difficulties proving any citizenship. Syria, for example, Syria had significant stateless populations before the conflict. So more than 500,000 stateless Palestinians from Syria and hundreds of thousands of stateless Kurds who already lived in Syria before the conflict. Syria also is one of the countries that has gender discrimination in its nationality law, which means that women don't have the same rights as men to confer their citizenship on their children, for example, particularly where children are born abroad. There are also major issues with civil registration in Syria and in the region around Syria, which means that children born in the region can face a risk of statelessness. Iraq, for example, similar to Syria, Iraq has significant stateless populations of Palestinians, Kurds, and other minority groups who've never had Iraqi nationality, as well as gender discriminatory nationality laws, which prevent some women from passing their nationality onto their children. Similarly, Iran also has gender discriminatory laws, as well as significant refugee, minority, and other potentially affected populations. You can find more information about gender discriminatory nationality laws and which states still have them at an excellent website in English, I'm afraid, but for those of you who can access information in English, the Global Campaign for Equal Nationality Rights has more information on that. And we also have developed a series of country position papers, which provide more detailed information on profiles of refugees who might be affected by statelessness and nationality problems. I think Alison is sharing the links in the chat now. You can find those on our Stateless Journeys website that we'll discuss a bit more detail later. So we have papers on Syria, Iraq, Iran, Myanmar, and Kuwait, all of which have significant populations at risk of statelessness. So people can be stateless before they arrive in a country to seek asylum, but for other people, statelessness can arise as a consequence of displacement. So it might only emerge during the course of return procedures, for example, if a country of origin refuses to recognize someone as a national over a long period of time, or if a person lacks any proof of place of birth or family links, and their state of origin refuses to recognize them. So the focus of a lot of your work, I guess, is likely to be securing someone's basic rights and protection, and that's understandable and right, but it's also important not to forget about nationality and to identify where statelessness could be an issue as well. As we've heard, everyone has a human right to a nationality, and lack of nationality can be a significant barrier to inclusion in the longer term, to naturalization, to return, and many kind of basic life administration and rights that we take for granted, like registering a birth or opening a bank account or getting married. So through research that we've done with our members who work on with refugees and affected communities across Europe, we've identified kind of five broad areas where stateless refugees or people affected by statelessness can face really particular challenges in the asylum process. And just to briefly give you a summary of those before I hand over to Patricia or actually to Vuk to share some of a couple of case studies from the Syrian Serbian context. I'll just briefly take you through these five areas where we think statelessness can be a problem in the refugee process. So first of all, the first one is registration. So what we see is often a failure to identify and accurately register statelessness on arrival. So this can lead to people being registered with what we call imputed nationality. So someone who's a Syrian, a Palestinian, stateless Palestinian from Syria arrives in a country and is asked, where have you come from? They say Syria, and they're recorded as having Syrian nationality. But that obviously hides their actual statelessness, as they don't actually hold Syrian citizenship. They're a stateless Palestinian from Syria. So that's we see this also happening with Kuwaiti Bedouin, for example, another population, well-known stateless population. They're registered as being Kuwaiti when in fact they don't hold that citizenship. So this means that statelessness gets missed at that very early point of registering nationality and details about individuals. Second area is around status determination, and Patricia will talk more about this in a moment, but statelessness is often missed or inadequately addressed in international protection procedures, which can lead to delays, inconsistencies, inadequate consideration of protection needs. Only a handful of countries in Europe have dedicated procedures to determine statelessness. So if someone's refused asylum, they could be left in limbo. And even where procedures do exist, awareness about them can be low, and there are often a lack of referral mechanisms to ensure people can access them. The third area is around detention and return. So all of the above can lead to people being refused protection and caught up in lengthy return procedures, unable to stay or get regularized their stay in a country, but unable to go anywhere either and unable to leave. And often people end up with no route to regularization in a country. The fourth area is around the child's right to a nationality. And as we've heard from Milan already, nationality laws are very complex and children can fall through the gaps. So also there can be discrimination, as we heard, where women can't confer their nationality to their children. Refugees perhaps can be unable to register the births of their children with their embassy for obvious reasons. If they're fearing persecution and they can't go to their own embassy to register the birth of the child. Sometimes that's required in the law for the child to acquire the nationality. Sometimes children don't have a birth certificate at all because they've been born in transit or en route somewhere on their journey. Some European countries have safeguards in their nationality laws to cover these situations, including Serbia. So Serbia does have a safeguard in the law to prevent children being born stateless, but sometimes the awareness of these safeguards is low or they're not actually implemented in practice to make sure that children acquire a nationality at birth. And then the last area is around long-term solutions and sort of durable solutions, if you like, to statelessness. So stateless people, for example, even if they're granted protection in a country, they sometimes can't meet the evidential requirements for naturalization. So they might not be able to provide, maybe a passport is required to naturalize or a birth certificate, and they can't meet that requirement in the law. Sometimes they can't meet requirements for family reunion, for example. So we've seen cases where family members in Syria or neighboring countries have faced really, really difficult hurdles to accessing family reunion in Europe. They've been asked to make very difficult, dangerous journeys to try and get documents that they don't have access to in conflict areas, for example. So they can face significant barriers to some of these other pathways to protection. So this is just a kind of broad overview of the issues that we see in relation to statelessness and refugee journeys in Europe. And now we're going to turn our attention a bit more closely to what's happening in Serbia and hear from a couple of case studies that Vuk is going to provide. And then Patricia is going to talk a bit more detail about the assessing statelessness in the context of international protection claims. So I'll hand over to you, Vuk.
Thank you so much, Nina. I hope you can still hear me well. I just wanted to briefly interrupt the presentation from Nina and Patricia and to share the experience that we've had in Serbia with our clients. I will just continue speaking in English for the sake of participants properly following and the interpretation. One of the examples was the unaccompanied child that was born in Pakistan and whose parents were originally from Afghanistan, but both of them had no personal documents when they left Afghanistan more than 20 years ago and moved to Pakistan, where their child was born. This child ended up in Serbia and it's currently in the asylum procedure. And the child, in the first instance, his asylum request was rejected. However, the Asylum Commission adopted our appeal and brought the case back to the first instance, and the procedure is still ongoing. So I would just like to share that this child has been recognized in Serbia as a stateless person by the asylum office during the procedure. The child explained that it had no documents whatsoever, that the parents also had no personal documents, and that there is no clear connection with both Pakistan and Afghanistan in terms of citizenship. And the asylum office did recognize this in the decision-making process, but however, when deciding upon the asylum request, they did not take into account in any way that the child was stateless and what human rights violations the child faced because of the statelessness. This is particularly serious, given in mind that Pakistan, the country where the child was born and where the child lived, didn't ratify neither the convention that deals with refugees, neither the conventions that deal with statelessness. So this is something that shows us a bit that the first instance decision-making authorities in Serbia do not take much into account what is going on if a person is stateless, not to mention that this was an unaccompanied child. And the second case that I wanted to share with you today deals with the family from Iran, who are also in the asylum procedure. They have also been going through first, second, and third instance. The administrative court adopted BCHR's lawsuit and brought back the case of this family to first instance. And the main reason was because the child that was born in Belgrade, in Serbia, was not taken into the procedure. The child was basically left out of the procedure, and all the decision making was only given for other family members, for the mother, father, and the son. However, the second child that was born here was not part of the procedure, even though BCHR legal team discussed this with the asylum office, and we provided information that the child was born. When the child was born, the birth certificate, the Serbian birth certificate, when we checked it out, we saw that in a bracket that deals with citizenship, it was already automatically assigned. The citizenship was automatically assigned, and it said that the child has Iranian citizenship. I think that we can also discuss this with Milan, but also with Yunina and Patricia. This is not a proper behavior from the authorities, proper assessment from the authorities to automatically assign citizenship, especially when the family is in the asylum procedure and they cannot reach out to the state of Iran in any way. And as a consequence to this, even though we treated the child as a de facto stateless child, the asylum office and later on the asylum commission, they treated the child as the citizen, as a citizen of Iran. So this is something that was quite different. They have given quite a different approach in comparison to the unaccompanied child from Pakistan who was recognized as stateless person. But for some reason, this issue of statelessness in his case was not properly assessed. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Vuk. I think that was really interesting to bridge from Nina's presentation and understanding how these challenges that we see Europe-wide also apply within the Serbian context. And I think these case examples are really useful for the exercise that we're going to do next as well, which is understanding how statelessness should be assessed in international protection claims and also why it is relevant within the asylum context, whether it can constitute persecution in itself, and what decision makers and authorities should take into consideration in assessing whether a person is stateless. So I'm going back to the start of Nina's presentation to look at the definition of a stateless person and the definition of a refugee. You've already heard a lot about the definition of a stateless person, but I also want you to focus now on the definition of a refugee according to the 1951 Refugee Convention. And this is a rewritten version of the definition, but essentially what the text says is that a refugee or a stateless refugee is a person who, not having a nationality and being outside of the country of his former habitual residence, is unable or unwilling to return to it, owing to a well-founded fear of being persecuted for reasons of race, religion, nationality, membership of a particular social group or political opinion. So the exact text of the two conventions is slightly different, because where the 1954 convention refers to stateless people, the 1951 Refugee Convention refers to not having a nationality. But even though the text is slightly different, the aim was still to use exactly the same concept of stateless person in both conventions, and they should be interpreted side by side. So not having a nationality is a concept that appears in the Refugee Convention as a ground for persecution, but also to establish the country of origin, for example, the country for cessation and exclusion from refugee status. Whenever nationality is uncertain or an applicant claims to be stateless, according to Article 1, then the decision makers should assess whether the applicant has a country of nationality, and if not, what is their country of former habitual residence, and then apply the rest of the criteria according to Article 1. And one key difference as well to note, if you read Article 1, is that for people who do not have a nationality, or let's say the other way around, so for nationals of a country, authorities must assess whether the person is unable or unwilling to avail themselves of the protection of the country. But actually, for people who do not have a nationality, what Article 1 says is that it should be assessed whether they are unable or unwilling to return to the country of former habitual residence. So it's slightly different. It's not about availing themselves of the protection, it's about being unable or unwilling to return to the country. I think, again, as I said, so to interpret what it means to not have a nationality, we need to consider the same guidance that we use to assess whether a person is stateless. And this assessment is different than assessing, than doing a formal determination of statelessness. One key thing to note as well is that refugee status should always be assessed prior to any formal determination of statelessness in countries that have an SDP especially. And this is to ensure that the primacy of the asylum claim and to ensure that we respect the principle of confidentiality, because asylum seekers may not be able to address the authorities of their country of origin due to fear of persecution. So this is also something that we need to take into consideration, and we'll talk a bit more about the tensions in evidencing statelessness in the context of asylum because of that.
Patricia, sorry to interrupt, just a slight comment from the interpreters. If you can just a bit more slowly, that would be really nice. Sorry to interrupt, but I think it's better that I take it from here.
No, that's absolutely fine. And my sincere apologies to the translators, because I get emotional about the topic and I get excited, but I will try to slow down. So guidance that we need to take into consideration on whether a person is stateless and in assessing refugee claims is the Refugee Convention and the 1954 Convention on the Protection of Stateless People. And then supporting these two conventions, there are two handbooks from UNHCR. One of them is on guidelines and on procedures and criteria for determining refugee status. And then the other one is the Handbook on Protection of Stateless Persons. And the Handbook on Protection of Stateless Persons is actually aimed at supporting the implementation of the 1954 Convention, but it does contain a number of very useful guidelines that allow us to assess which evidence should be taken into consideration to assess if a person is stateless. It also contains information on, for example, which countries should be assessed, and that's all that we're going to talk about now in the next slides. Other international norms that are also important to consider is everything under international human rights law. All of the instruments that the country may have ratified. So, for example, we've talked about today about the Convention on the Rights of the Child, the Convention on the elimination of discrimination against women. All of these conventions need to be interpreted systemically. So it's the body of all these instruments that that grants protection to stateless refugees. And then finally, we also need to look at case law, including case law from regional international courts. And we'll talk today about examples from case law from international courts, but also cases from domestic courts, and we'll give you examples of how courts in other countries are handling issues around assessing statelessness in an asylum claim. So to establish statelessness, authorities must first consider that it needs to the person needs to prove a negative. So the person needs to prove that they are not a national of another country. And this comes attached with a number of difficulties in showing evidence that the person is not a national. So there may not be one document saying that the person is stateless. So there may be actually quite a general lack of evidence. And it's about somehow not finding any evidence that the person is a national of a particular country. Nationality does not need to be established in relation to every country in the world. So the authority should only assess the countries with which the person has a relevant link. And that link can be because the person was born in that country or has descent, their parents are from that country, or through marriage, adoption, or habitual residence, for example. So if the person has one of these links to a country, then it can be assessed whether the person is a national of that country, but not in relation to other states with which the person does not have a link. And then when we look at the definition of a stateless person, and it does say that the person is not a national of any state under the operation of its law. And this part, under the operation of its law, also means that we need to look at not only at the laws of the country, but also at its implementation in practice by the authorities. So law includes the general laws, but also ministerial decrees, regulations, case law, and how the authorities are applying the law, particularly in relation to that person. And the UNHCR, for example, says that the definition of statelessness also covers situations where the written law is substantially modified when it comes to implementation in practice. So even if the authorities are applying the law differently, the person will still be stateless. How to assess evidence? First of all, authorities should consider all available evidence, not just documentary evidence. So they can consider testimonies or information from UNHCR or any sort of school or medical records, for example. It's quite common, due to the nature of statelessness, that applicants don't have any documentary evidence. And if they are refugees, they will also not be able to contact the authorities of their country of origin to obtain confirmation of their nationality status or of their statelessness. So this is important in ensuring in assessing the burden of proof. So which should essentially be shared between the applicant and the examiner, and they should cooperate together to obtain all available evidence. So if the applicant does not have any documents to show as evidence, but their account appears to be credible, they should still be given the benefit of the doubt and considered to be stateless. And we have an example here of a judgment from the European Court of Human Rights, where it stated that there are no reasons to doubt the applicant's arguments that he was advised by the Albanian authorities that he was not an Albanian national. And so if there are no reasons to doubt what the applicant is saying, then the applicant should be considered stateless. We also need to consider that refugee status determination has a declaratory nature. So it needs to be assessed in relation to whether the applicant is currently stateless. So it doesn't matter if the applicant can in the future acquire a nationality, or there is the possibility that by doing a certain action, they might acquire a nationality. It really matters whether they are at the moment stateless. And a refugee claim cannot be refused based on a hypothetical step that the person could acquire a nationality and protection in a different state. Also, because we really need to consider that many states have discretionary and arbitrary practices in terms of granting nationality. So once it has been established that the applicant does not have a nationality, according to the Refugee Convention, the fear of persecution should be assessed in relation to the country of their former habitual residence. So the authorities need to establish what is a former habitual residence. that is a factual assessment. It's not based on law. And so it can also include any regions, areas, or territories that might not necessarily be understood as a state. So for example, a stateless person who has always lived in a refugee camp in Algeria, for that person, the authorities may consider that the person is unable to return to the refugee camp. And for example, the French court has already considered that in a case similar to this one, they were habitually resident in the camp and they were subject to the control of the authorities of the camp. But also, for example, in relation to stateless Palestinians from the West Bank, Australian courts have already considered that Palestine is not capable of granting nationality, but that is not required to assess whether the person is unable to return to the country of formal habitual residence. So if the person is unable to return to the West Bank, that will be considered. And as I was saying, so this is a factual assessment, and the person does not necessarily have to lawfully reside in that territory, nor have the right to return to that territory. So it should only be assessed whether the person has resided there and there was some degree of establishment. Also, well-founded fear of persecution only needs to be established in at least one country of former habitual residence, not in relation to all the countries where the person has already lived. So we have now considered how the authorities should assess whether a person is not stateless within the refugee status determination. But another aspect of statelessness within refugee law is also whether statelessness in itself can constitute persecution. So statelessness per se does not give rise to refugee status, nor only the inability of a person to return to a country of former habitual residence, because the person also needs to fill all the other criteria according to the Refugee Convention. And they also need, for example, to establish that they have a well-founded fear of persecution in one of the grounds of the convention. But there are still situations where the consequences of statelessness or the reason why the person was rendered stateless may be considered persecution. So in this first example, we're looking at how denial of nationality may constitute persecution. And this refers to persons who never had a nationality, and they were usually denied a nationality on the basis of a protected status, for example, race or gender. So they may have been born and always lived in a country, but they could never acquire the nationality of that country due to discriminatory grounds. And going back to what we said earlier, here is, for example, where international human rights law is really relevant, because Milan has already referenced, for example, the Convention on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women states that countries should grant women equal rights with men to acquire nationality. Also, the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination prohibits discrimination on the grounds of race, color, or ethnicity in the enjoyment of the right to nationality. And there are other instruments where discrimination is prohibited on several grounds, and that's specifically referred to nationality. So where there is evidence that the nationality laws of a country are discriminatory against one of these protected grounds, then international human rights law is engaged. And courts in several countries have already recognized that denial of nationality on these discriminatory grounds leads to persecution for the purposes of the convention. And we have examples from the UK, from Germany, or from France, for example. And one that that is highlighted here is from the French National Court of Asylum. In a case where a Palestinian was born in Egypt to an Egyptian mother and a Palestinian father, and lived there for 30 years. But the Egyptian laws did not allow people with Palestinian origins to acquire Egyptian nationality. So the French court considered that these provisions in Egyptian law and the consequences of statelessness that are particularly severe meant that the applicant had a well-founded fear of being persecuted in Egypt for political and ethnic reasons and therefore should be granted stateless status, refugee status. Another way that statelessness can constitute persecution is in cases of deprivation of nationality, especially where deprivation of nationality was conducted in violation of international and human rights law. So this is particularly the case if the deprivation of nationality rendered the person stateless, because it may be contrary to the 1961 Convention on the Reduction of Statelessness. Or if deprivation was discriminatory on the basis of a protected ground, again, so if the authorities deprive the person of nationality due to their race or their gender or their ethnicity or political opinion, that is also against international human rights law. And again, several courts have also considered that withdrawal of nationality leading to statelessness on a ground protected by the Refugee Convention amounts to persecution without needing to show any additional harm. And here we see an example from the German Federal Administrative Court that considered that deprivation of citizenship deprives the individual in question of his or her fundamental status as citizen, and it causes ongoing significant harm to the individual concerned. Therefore, it amounted to persecution, and the person should also be granted refugee status. Another way that statelessness can amount to persecution is if the person is refused to re-enter their own country. So this doesn't apply to stateless people, but Article 12 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights has states that no one shall be arbitrarily deprived of the right to enter his own country. And a person's own country is different than nationality. The UN Human Rights Committee has already stated that the right of a person to enter their own country recognizes the special relationship of a person to that country. And the scope of his own country is broader than the concept of nationality. So a person may be unable to re-enter their own country if that's not necessarily their country of nationality. And if that happens, that will be in violation of Article 12. And another way that we can look at the refusal to re-enter a country is due to the impact on the enjoyment of other rights. So several courts have also considered that the violation of a person's right to return to and to reside in their own country has an impact on their access to rights and can in itself constitute persecution. And this applies whether people are being denied re-entry on any grounds. So it can be on political, racial, ethnic grounds, but also simply on the grounds that they are stateless or that they lack of nationality, because that's also a protected ground under the Refugee Convention. Then finally, another aspect is the impact that statelessness has on the enjoyment of other rights. And as we know, stateless people face insurmountable obstacles in securing access to rights. And for example, the rights guaranteed under the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights must be ensured in relation to all people within a state's territory, regardless of their nationality or statelessness. So denial of these rights on the grounds of statelessness may constitute persecution. If the fact that a person is stateless may lead to them being subject to physical injury or detention or arrest, deportation, that in itself can constitute persecution as well. And sometimes this is also combined with, for example, difficulty in obtaining birth registration certificates or identity documents, or the challenges associated with living in a refugee camp. We also need to look at the impact that economic that citizens has on economic and social rights, because many times people may be unable to access education, healthcare, or workers' rights. So if people, due to their statelessness, are preventing from enjoying all of these rights, then that can be a ground for persecution under the Refugee Convention. And this is, for example, a very real issue in Kuwaiti Bidun, which is one of the very well-known stateless populations worldwide. And the UK courts have already found that undocumented Bidun suffered treatment amounting to persecution on the ground that without documents, they cannot access any form of social services, education, healthcare, and benefits in Kuwait. And in a judgment that my colleague can also share with you, a UK court found that the authorities in Kuwait acted to exclude most Bidun from accessing Kuwaiti nationality and a lawful resident status. And then they restricted access to all civil, political, and economic rights to those that either have a Kuwaiti nationality or a foreign nationality. So people without a nationality in Bidun, stateless people in Kuwait, stateless people in Kuwait were actually victims of a deliberate state policy to drive them out of the country, and that amounts to persecution. So eventually the UK courts found that the treatment of undocumented Bidun amounts to persecution based on the denial of their civil and political rights, as well as their economic and social rights. Two other things that I also want to note in the context of the Refugee Convention is Article 1D and 1E, which are grounds for people to be excluded from protection of the Refugee Convention. In relation to Article 1D, this covers persons who are receiving protection from other UN agencies. For example, UNRWA, which protects stateless Palestinians. And people may be excluded from the Refugee Convention under Article 1D, but this really needs to be assessed carefully. Also taking into consideration the scope of protection provided by UNRWA, its areas of operation, and also the individual circumstances of the applicant. And as an example, we can look at case law from the Court of Justice of the European Union that says that, for example, if a person is registered with UNRWA, they may not be excluded from protection if their personal safety is at serious risk, and if it is impossible for UNRWA to guarantee that the person has adequate living conditions in the camps. And therefore, if the person was forced to leave the UNRWA's area of operations because of those conditions, or if they cease to receive this protection due to reasons beyond their control, in all of these circumstances, the person may still be entitled to refugee status. So it really needs to be applied carefully. Then under Article 1E of the Refugee Convention, persons recognized by the competent authorities of the country where they reside as having the rights and obligations which are attached to the possession of nationality of that country, those persons are also excluded from protection. But for this article to be applied, the authorities really have to recognize that stateless people have the same rights than their nationals. So it also needs to be applied very narrowly. And then one final note on the connection with between statelessness and refugee law is that sometimes people may not necessarily be entitled to refugee status because they do not meet one of the criteria in the Refugee Convention. But there are still several jurisdictions that have provisions for subsidiary or complementary protection alongside the provisions for refugee status. And there may also be provisions in place to grant some form of tolerated status to people who cannot, for example, be returned or deported. So if the person has failed to secure asylum status, the person can still access one of these alternative forms of protection if they are stateless. And they may also be protected against deportation in all cases. And within the context of the Council of Europe, one key article here is Article 3 of the European Convention on Human Rights, which prohibits torture and inhumane or degrading treatment. So a person cannot be returned to a country where they could face a risk of degrading treatment. And many times stateless people might face that risk because they will be completely unable to secure any economic and social rights. And this is a lower threshold than persecution. So even if a person is not entitled to refugee status, they may still be entitled, they may still be protected by the principle of non-refoulement of Article 3 of the European Convention on Human Rights. Although, even if they are protected against deportation, the protection that they will actually receive in the country will depend on national law and whether the country has any specific protection for people who cannot be deported. And then there are also other forms of protection in national law that may arise. And it would be interesting to hear from you about your perspective on this as well. But one example that I also wanted to highlight here is in Czech Republic, where the law has recently changed, but up until recently, statelessness could be determined under the provisions of the Asylum Act. And even though there was no specific SDP in place, our members in Czech Republic conducted a lot of litigation with the courts, and they were eventually able to secure a legal status, an identity card for stateless people, and also access to housing where their statelessness was being determined. And all of this was in comparison to the rights that asylum seekers had in national law. So this has now recently changed, and we're still to see how these cases can still be relevant within the Czech context, but I still wanted to highlight how we can still secure rights to protect stateless people by comparison to refugee or asylum seekers, for example. And that's it from my part of the presentation. I'll hand back to Nina to talk about some of the tools and resources.
Thanks so much, Patricia. That was really, really interesting. And I'm sure there might be some questions for discussion. But just very briefly to finish our presentation, I wanted to share a few of the tools and resources that we've developed with our members to support the work of refugee response actors, lawyers, decision makers, and also stateless refugees and asylum seekers. And please do also let us know if there are other tools or resources that you would find useful. We'd be more than happy to discuss that further with you if there's anything that you need to support your work on with stateless people. So firstly, just to point out our Stateless Journeys website or Knowledge Hub, where you can find a whole host of information, mostly in English, I'm afraid, but there are a few translated documents available in the resources section. But we're working on this website all the time and aiming for this to be a knowledge hub where you can find more information about how statelessness affects refugees in different ways. And on the resources section, I think on the next slide, Patricia, you can find different tools, including one briefing there that I found in Serbian that Praxis worked on us with a few years ago. But also we have leaflets for refugees that are available in French, Arabic, Farsi, and English that you can download and use if you're working with people just about what statelessness is and how it might affect them. And then we also have the country position papers I mentioned earlier on how statelessness and nationality problems might affect people from Syria, Iraq, Iran, Kuwait, and Myanmar. Then we also have our Statelessness Index that you might be familiar with, which with thanks to the hard work of Milan and others at Praxis, we maintain every year. We have a country profile on Serbia in the index that Praxis works on us with, and we update that every year. So there's lots of information in the index about law, policy, and practice in Serbia specifically. We're also currently working to translate the index country profiles. So hopefully by next year, we'll have the country profile available in Serbian as well as in English. But we do already have a briefing that you can download in Serbian, which highlights some of the key challenges on statelessness in Serbia with some recommendations for the government as well. And then Patricia already mentioned our other tool, which is our statelessness case law database, which is a labor of love, as we say in English, Patricia, and our members have been working really hard to upload case summaries from lots of different jurisdictions relating to statelessness. So you can find lots of cases in there, and we're constantly adding more to that as well. And then lastly, we always end our presentations with some tips on, you know, we tend to raise lots of problems in these presentations and there aren't always easy solutions. So here are just a few suggestions of things that you can do and we can all do to try and address statelessness better in our work. So the first one is get trained. So you've already done that one. You're coming here today to talk about statelessness, which is great. But we, ENS provides training regularly to different actors working on statelessness. We'd be more than happy to come and do more dedicated training. So do get in touch with us if that's of interest. And also, if you're not already members of ENS and you're working on statelessness, feel free to get in touch with us and ask about membership. It's free, and we provide access to a litigation working group, for example, to other training opportunities, conferences and projects that we work on with our members. And do reach out to us and get in touch if you have any questions after today, or if there's anything that you would find useful in your work that we can help with, please do get in touch. So I think we'll probably stop there. You can find our email addresses there and Twitter and websites if you want to get in touch, please do. And yeah, we'd be more than happy to answer any questions that anyone might have for me or for Patricia.
Thank you, Nina and Patricia, so much for this presentation. I hope that everyone finds it as useful as I do. And now I will switch to Serbian just to inform everyone about the panel discussion. Of course, everyone who needs to use translation, you can switch in the translation part to from Serbian to English. Dakle, hvala još jednom zaista na ovim detaljnim prezentacijama i Milanu i Nini i Patriciji i hvala naravno i Elison koja je tu da nam podeli sve linkove koji su nam sada dostupni, koje možete pronaći u chat boxu. Mi ćemo se naravno potruditi da vam dostavimo sve ove linkove i prezentacije i putem maila, s obzirom da ste se registrovali svi, da je vaše mail adrese već imamo, napravit ćemo sažetak svega ovoga i poslati vam na mail. Pre nego što otvorim panel diskusiju, ja bih samo da se osvrnem na pitanje koje smo već dobili u chat boxu, koje je upućeno bilo Milanu, a vidim da je Milan i odgovorio. Samo da na početku se nalazi. Ako se ne varam, to je koleginica Nataša Pavićević iz Ministarstva za rad, boračka i socijalna pitanja, koja je Milanu postavila pitanje kako se postaje apatrid vezano za surogat roditeljstvo, jer tamo gdje nije zakonom dozvoljeno surogat roditeljstvo, Milan je odgovorio da surogat materinstvo ostavlja mnogo decu u riziku od apatridije zbog brojnih kompleksnih pitanja koje se odnosi na to ko se u pravnom smislu smatra roditeljem. Takođe, u zemljama koje ne priznaju surogat materinstvo postoji problem oko upisa tog deteta u matičnu knjigu rođenih, pa ne znam da li Nataša želi da se uključi da eventualno nešto još doda, ili Milan, ili Nina i Patricija. Ukoliko ne, možda možemo da otvorimo panel diskusiju ukoliko neko ima dodatna pitanja. Slobodno možete kliknuti na dugme koje kaže raise hand ili podigni ruku, tako da ukoliko neko ima pitanje, može slobodno da nam se i na taj način javi.
Maybe just while we're waiting for questions, I could signpost in relation to that question about surrogacy. There is some relevant case law from the European Court of Human Rights that perhaps Patricia or Alison could share that might be of interest, and also an advisory opinion from a year or two ago from the European Court of Human Rights on this question of surrogacy. But as Milan replied, it is a complex issue and does depend on the regulations around surrogacy, particularly where there's a cross-border element to it. It can be quite complex and create a risk of statelessness in some cases.
Evo, mogao bih možda, ako nema još pitanja u vezi s tim, samo da dodam, nedavno nam se obratio za pomoć jedan čovjek iz Amerike, čini mi se, koji je postao otac na osnovu surogat roditeljstva, a pritom je majka, odnosno donorka, je bila anonimna. Tako da je u tom izvodu iz knjige rođenih upisan samo on kao otac, a podataka o majci nema. I on je sad pokušao da svoje dete upiše ovdje u matične knjige u Srbiji, ali kako kod nas nije regulisano i nije dozvoljeno surogat materinstvo, rečeno mu je da ne može da se upiše ovdje u matične knjige, jer kod nas, po našim propisima, otprilike rečeno, majkom se smatra žena koja je rodila dete, a ovdje uopšte nema majke, nije upisana u tom dokumentu izvodu iz matične knjige rođenih i ne može da se upiše kod nas u naše matične knjige. Ja pretpostavljam da je to dete moglo da dobije državljanstvo ako je rođeno u Americi, pošto se tamo državljanstvo stiče po osnovu rođenja, ali da nije taj slučaj, to dete bi ostalo bez državljanstva. Ako otac jeste bio naš državljanin, a dete ne bi moglo da se upiše ovdje samim tim i da dobije državljanstvo Srbije, tako je to je potencijalni izvor apatridije i surogat materinstva.
Hvala Milane i hvala i Nina. Vidim da Jelena Milanić iz UNHCR-a im je podigla ruku, tako da Jelena, izvoli.
Hvala Vuče. Dobar dan svima. Želeo bih da vas pozdravim sve i da se zahvalim Beogradskom centru za organizovanje ovog webinara i naravno Praksisu, Vuku i Milanu i Evropskoj mreži za apatridiju koja se uključila. Meni je bio izuzetno interesantan webinar. Otvorili smo neka pitanja koja ovdje na ovim našim prostorima nisu toliko, da kažem, eksploatisana kada govorimo o apatridiji. Mi više pričamo o riziku od apatridije nego o osobama koje su na teritoriji i stvarno su apatridi, a pritom nemaju još uvijek mogućnost da prođu kroz odgovarajuću proceduru da taj svoj status i utvrde, iako je, kao što je Milan rekao, se kao takvi spominju kao osobe koje imaju pristup odgovarajućim pravima. Htela sam da kažem da bi možda bilo dobro da nakon ovog izvučemo i neke stvari na koje bismo mogli da obratimo pažnju i da možda iskoristimo i saradnju koju trenutno i dalje UNHCR ima sa Ministarstvom za državnu upravu i lokalnu samoupravu, možda upravo onim pitanjima koje se tiču upisa u matičnu knjigu rođenih kada imamo decu čiji su roditelji stranci, kada po defaultu matičari, da tako kažem, sami dodeljuju državljanstvo detetu, da možda bar takve situacije sprečimo gde će se u stvari sakriti činjenica da dete u određenoj situaciji može biti apatrid. Pored toga, naravno, tu smo i za sve dalje vrste saradnje koje se tiču u bilo kom obliku apatridije i nastavljamo da radimo zajedno. Samo sam želela da vam se zahvalim za organizaciju webinara.
Hvala Jelena i naravno hvala UNHCR-u na podršci u organizovanju ovakvog webinara. Mislim da je zaista to od velike važnosti da imamo tu mogućnost da dve važne teme iz ljudskog prava i apatridiju povežemo na ovaj način kako smo to učinili danas. Ja bih se, ukoliko nemamo još pitanja, vratio na ovaj primjer deteta koje je rođeno u Beogradu, čiji roditelji su iranski državljani, kome je u matičnu knjigu rođenih upisano po nekom automatizmu iransko državljanstvo i koja se u postupku azila sada smatra od strane relevantnih organa kao iranska državljanka. Čisto volio bih da čujem komentare od vas, ukoliko biste bili ljubazni od Nine, Patricije i Milana, vezano za ovaj slučaj, koliko to može pozitivno ili negativno da utiče na slučaj čitave porodice, naravno, ali konkretno i deteta kome je dodeljeno po automatizmu iransko državljanstvo. Možda možemo od Nine da krenemo.
Mogu ja, ako, ovaj, eto, ako, naravno, nije na svakako ako želi, nek samo izvoli. Ovaj.
Može, Milane, naravno.
Pošto sam imao već spremno, ovaj, pošto smo i sami imali ovaj, više takvih slučajeva, pre svega, naravno, mora da se naglasi da je to potpuno nedopustivo da naši matičari upisuju matične knjige državljanstva neke druge zemlje. Oni mogu da upišu samo da li je dete državljanin Srbije ili nije državljanin Srbije. Dakle, uopšte ne bi smeli ni kad imaju roditelji državljanstva neke zemlje, ne zna oni kako je pravo te zemlje da bi upisali ovaj to, a pogotovo je nedopustivo da u slučajima kad roditelji nemaju nikakve dokumente, a to imali smo takve primere, dakle, roditelji kažu da su, na primjer, iz Irana i matičar upiše, aha, dete je državljanin Irana. I eto šta se posle dešava, dakle, imamo tu kod vas situaciju negativnu u vezi sa postupkom azila, a takođe tu ovaj, dolazi opet opasnost od apatridije dete, zato što roditeljima, na primjer, mogu da budu u zabludi, dobio taj izvod iz matične knjige rođenih i vidi, piše, negde ga prevedu posle i piše tu, ili dobio internacionalni izvod i piše tu da je državljanin, ovaj, njihovo dete državljanin neke zemlje, naprosto, iako nema, u stvari ne ispunjava, ne samo da nije dobilo, nego možda uopšte ne ispunjava uslova za državljanstvo te zemlje, i žive, recimo, u zabludi da je dete državljanin, a posle tek jednog dana ustanove da nema državljanstva, a može umeđu vremenu i da protekne rok za sticanje državljanstva u toj zemlji, tako da ostane bez državljanstva. S druge strane, čini mi se da je to neki način da se kod nas izbegne da deta, Jelena je ovaj, nešto u tom smislu i rekla, ovaj, da dete dobije državljanstvo ovde posle urođenja, što bi trebalo da bude slučaj ako roditelji nisu državljani ni jedne zemlje. Dakle, to dakle, može da bude ta praksa i neki kao način izbegavanja da dete dobije državljanstvo Srbije. I samo bih još nešto rekao, što je opet, to je retko kad možda se pohvale ovaj, naši organi, ali eto i da neku ruku da se pohvale, da oni, da eto i naše ne baš mnogo velike prakse sa osobama, izbeglicama koje su ovde dobiju decu, ovaj, da su hteli da upisuju matičari rođenje deteta, iako roditelji nisu imali dokumente, pasoše. To matičari neće da rade kada je reč o deci koje su odavde, dakle, čiji roditelji nemaju dokumente, ali eto, hoće, što je dobro, iako bi propisi kažu da se podaci o roditeljima upisuju na osnovu putne isprave roditelja, ali i kada nemaju roditelji, dakle, stranci dokumente, matičari su do sada uglavnom upisivali tu decu, valjda računajući da će brzo da se izgube odavde, pa onda neće biti, ovaj, kako oni to gledaju, teret na ovom.
Ako mogu ja da se ubacim ovde, pa to je u nekom trenutku, ovaj, ne znam, negde bio i razlog da mi nismo, da tako kažem, ovaj, na ovaj problem ukazivali matičarima kada smo radili sa njima, jer smo bili na početku, da tako kažem, srećni što su uopšte evidentirali ovu decu, jer imamo dugo godina problem sa, pre svega sa decom iz romske populacije koja nisu uopšte upisane na matične knjige rođenih zato što roditelji nemaju ličnu dokumentaciju. I onda kada su uzeli i upisali su ove decu, ljudi koji su prolazili u to vreme preko teritorije, onda smo rekli pa sad ovo možda i nije tako loše, jer ako ništa drugo, bar će to dete imati, odnosno roditelji imaće neki trag i dokaz o tome gde im se rodilo dete i potvrdu da su oni eventualno roditelji, pa da u tom smislu će se smanjiti i za to dete riziko da apatridije. E sad, ovo je već neki treći nivo kada krenu na, u taj pravac da mu određuju državljanstvo, pa iz toga, pošto vidim da su ovdje danas nama predstavnici nekih različitih naših partnerskih organizacija, predložila da kada god se takva situacija desi, da savjetuju roditelji i pruže im pravnu pomoć da ovakvu činjenicu isprave u matičnim knjigama kod nas i roditeljima omoguće da dobiju odgovarajući dokument u kome neće postojati ovakav podatak koji nije ispravan. Možda bi to bilo i za Beogradski centar u ovoj situaciji kada je dete u proceduri azila, ne znam da li je okončana procedura ili ne, da se možda i naknadno dostavi dokument ispravljen gde se vidi da gde u stvari bi se ta rubrika u kojoj se upisuje državljanstvo deteta bila prazna. Toliko, hvala.
Hvala Jelena, hvala Milane. Da li Nina, možda i Patricija žele da dodaju nešto još?
Yeah, no, it's really interesting to hear the discussion and thank you for raising the question, because this is something that we see in many countries, not just in Serbia. So it's an issue that we've identified more broadly, and one of the key problems seems to be a lack of guidance and norms around determining a child's nationality. So one question is access to birth registration, and I hear what you're saying about that really important step to make sure at least there's a document to prove the birth has taken place, where the child was born and who the parents are. That's the really important first step. But I guess the issue that's arising now is the next step around what nationality does that child have. So it's not just important for the child to have a legal identity, but also that every child, in line with Article 7 of the Child Rights Convention, has the right to a nationality or requires a nationality as soon as possible after birth. And that seems to be a common issue in many countries, particularly in this context of the refugee context, where there may be a lack of understanding on the part of officials or a lack of guidance and awareness about, for example, gender discrimination and nationality laws, which means that children are not automatically able to acquire the nationality of their parents. And so there needs to be, I think, a few different actions taken. One of them is to have better guidance in place for what to do in these kind of situations, and also more information available to officers who are having to carry out civil registration about who might be at risk, so which children to look out for. So the case of Iran is an obvious one, like also Iraq or Syria, where there is this clear gender discrimination in the nationality law, and to make better information available so that this can be flagged somehow, so that it can be noted that this child could be at risk of statelessness and that there needs to be a further investigation into the nationality of that child. And I think, yeah, I'm signposting to good legal advice, and you're very lucky in Serbia that you have Praxis Belgrade Centre working on these issues with that expertise to be able to provide that advice. But that's really important as well. And you're also fortunate in Serbia that the nationality citizenship law includes a safeguard for otherwise stateless children born on the territory. So that safeguard, where it applies, can be activated, and that, you know, children who are otherwise stateless can acquire Serbian citizenship, but that would require legal advice. You know, implementation of that provision can be challenging. I know from Milan and Praxis's work on it that it can be challenging. But the law is there, and it's almost a question of joining up these different aspects to center in on the child's rights and the child's best interests and what should happen with every child. And I would signpost you again, we've mentioned them a few times, to our country position papers on, for example, in this case on Iran. We have one on Iran that sets out the nationality laws of Iran, some of the populations that could be at risk. So you could use that. It is in English, but hopefully it's still useful to refer to and provide a bit more information to explain the situation of this particular child, of Iranian parents, where the child is born abroad, for example. So, yeah, it's really interesting to have this discussion, an important discussion to have, and we'd be very happy to continue the discussion if it's useful, and to share some experiences from other countries as well. I don't know if Patricia has anything else to add on that. No.
Hvala Nina puno na vašem komentaru. Sada je 2 minuta do 13 časova, što znači da smo negdje došli na sam kraj današnjeg webinara. Ukoliko nemamo više pitanja, ja koliko sada ovdje mogu da vidim, nemamo. Ja ću vas zamoliti samo za jednu stvar koju, nažalost, imajući u vidu da se nalazimo u online formatu, to bi više izgledalo kao grupna fotografija gdje bismo se svi zajedno slikali, ali s obzirom da smo na Zoomu, zamolit ću sve one kojima je naravno u redu da uključe i osjećaju se komfortno da uključe svoju kameru, da napravimo jedan print screen gde ćemo svi zajedno da ovekovečimo ovaj današnji webinar. Ako vam nije problem, koleginica Vesna će da bude ta koja će da nam napravi ove print screenove. Mi ćemo naravno, ukoliko se svi slažete, objaviti to u okviru nekih vesti i na našim društvenim mrežama, da smo danas bili svi zajedno na ovom webinaru. Naravno, svako ko se osjeća komfortnim može uključiti kameru, ukoliko ne, naravno, ne morate to da uradite. a ja bih u ovom trenutku da se još jednom zaista svima vama zahvalim što ste danas bili sa nama. U jednom trenutku nas je bilo 42, sada nas je 38 i jako mi je drago što smo se okupili ovako prilično velikom broju da razgovaramo na ovu temu. Naravno, Beogradski centar za ljudska prava će nastaviti da prati ovo i da radi na ovoj temi, odnosno ovoj nekoj cross-cutting temi koja podrazumeva i apatridiju i izbjegličko pravo, i u konsultaciji sa našim dragim kolegama iz organizacije Praksis i iz Evropske mreže za apatridiju, ali i sa svim drugim našim partnerskim organizacijama i organizacijama koje prate ovu temu. Nadam se da ćemo uspjeti da što je moguće više približimo da uokvirimo rad tako da oni ljudi koji su u riziku od apatridije i koji se nalaze u postupku azila mogu da na najbolji mogući način ostvare svoja prava kroz besplatnu pravnu pomoć koju mi pružamo, naravno i kroz druge usluge koje pružaju naše partnerske organizacije. Ja u ovom trenutku hoću da se zahvalim i našim dragim prevodiocima, Stefanu i Tini, koji su bili tu uz nas ova prethodna dva sata. UNHCR-u, naravno, na podršci organizaciji ovog događaja, i svim mojim dragim kolegama iz Beogradskog centra za ljudska prava i Praksisa i Evropske mreže za apatridiju da u organizaciji ovog događaja. I što se mene tiče, to bi bilo to za danas. Hvala vam još jednom i želim vam svaku dobru radu i naravno da nam se, barem što se Beograda tiče, ne znam kako je na drugim mjestima, da nam se malo razvedri, s obzirom da smo počeli dan sa veoma velikom kišom i sa neonako baš prijatnim već tmurnim vremenom. Nadam se da ste zaista uživali u prethodna dva sata i da ćete poneti dobro iskustvo sa ovog webinara. Svako dobro i ostajemo u kontaktu. Pozdrav svima!